Hi everyone, it is a pleasure to be here, and today I'm going to hopefully not bore you with my story. Before I tell you about my work, I would like to tell you a little bit of myself and what led me to this journey. When I was 3 weeks old, I had a severe meningitis attack, which made me lose my hearing as well as my smell, which is actually a great thing because that means I can sleep peacefully at night. अगर मुझे किसी की बकवास नहीं सुननी तो मैं बंद कर सकता हूँ, आल आउट आ सकता हूँ. यू नो, आई वाज बोर्न इन 1986. एट दैट टाइम देयर वर नॉट मेनी अपॉर्चुनिटीज अवेलेबल टू पेरेंट्स और चिल्ड्रन विद डिसेबिलिटीज और हैंडीकैप एंड नो डिफरेंटली एबल एस्पेक्ट. एट दैट टाइम एवरीबडी यूज्ड टू टेल माई मदर माई फादर के आई वुड हैव टू गो टू अ साइन लैंग्वेज स्कूल. लेकिन माई मदर वॉन्टेड मी टू स्पीक. She trained to be a speech therapist. And she trained to be a speech therapist. My father trained to be an audiologist. And because of them, I am where I am today. You know, like they say, when something is taken from you, then you are given something more. I believe for me, it was the sense of trying to see a good side in people, a good side in places, and what have you. So over here, you know, today, you can see that hearing aids, they fit right into my ear. You cannot see them right now. But back then, you could see it. That is me at a very young age, and you can see that, you know, my hearing aids is really big. So I used to be very conscious. I did not want to interact with, you know, normal hearing peers. So I used to be very conscious, and everybody used to ask me, kya apne kya pehne? I used to tell them it's radio. I used to make up all such stories. And I was very introverted. Fast forward to O levels, one of the first digital cameras had just come out. And fortunately, as luck would have it, my father was a hobbyist photographer. So he gave me a camera. And I started taking it to school. And one day, a classmate of mine got into a fight over a girl or whatever it was. And he stormed out into the basketball court to cry. But he did not know that I was also there with my camera. So I had two options. Should I let this moment pass or should I capture this moment? A special moment. And I decided to do the latter. I decided to capture it. And that made me develop a strong connection with raw human emotion. And since then I have been very interested in human nature in general as a portrait photographer and a photojournalist. Before I show you my work, I want to show something, and I'm going to show up a lot about this. Obviously that's not my picture. That was taken in 1942. That's my grandmother's picture. In the middle you see my grandmother taking a picture, and over there you see three of her sisters. I would call it the first selfie in the subcontinent. I studied painting, which made me appreciate photography, and I was a hobbyist photographer on one side and I was an art student. And both ran in parallel. You know, as a photographer, I learned how to open a dialogue with everybody. You know how they say art and photography transcend all barriers, and that helped me transcend a lot of barriers, whether it was physical or lingual. I have the privilege of having traveled all over the country where people speak different languages. And over here, I am photographing somebody in Upper Hunza. Now I will tell you about my work and something that is very close to my heart, which is my first book. Don't worry, I'm not going to tell you about my qualification. My education is my travels. You know, one day I was traveling in Thatta, in Chin, and this girl, she started following me everywhere. And I wanted to photograph her, so I pointed my camera towards her. And she put a veil on and she told me to now take a picture. She put her hands together. I call her my personal Mona Lisa. When I travel to Hunza, I try not to focus on landscape too much, but try to focus on the people. And last couple of years, I have been trying to learn the local language, which is Waki, and I have been trying to understand the culture. So I was passing through the door, and this lady, she called me in and she wanted me to have some tea and something. And when I went inside, I left the door open by accident. And she told me in her language, close the door. And she put his horn behind her head and she said, close the door, otherwise the devil will come in. And I was confused about it, because I didn't really understand what she was saying. So after I left, my grandson told me, she said, close the door, otherwise a cow will come in. And that's her, and that's my picture with her. The key to portrait is always to try and get a trust of your subject. And never to treat it as a portrait, but as a dialogue. Because every person you cross on the street has a story. Literally. And it's also about how you create an image. Here there was this lady, and she was very stiff, but she was very photogenic. And she had gold teeth. So I told her to, not pose like I'm taking a passport photograph. So I asked my translator to tell that to her. And that was the reaction. With others, it's a very interesting story. This is a nice read. I don't think you can tell in the projector position right now. But over here, it was a shoot that lasted about 15-20 minutes. And I always want to get a reaction out of them that you normally don't get to see. And one day, after almost 6 months of coordination, the ISPR called me and they said, are you free at 3 o'clock? Which was 1.5 hours ahead. And I said, yes, I am. And well, they called me. It was the first day of Ramzan, so both of us were fasting. I could not shoot, he could not pose. So I told him that and he started laughing. I personally see some portraits and some shoots as a reflection of myself, and I try to take some pictures that can also mirror your experiences as well. But Emanuele, she suffers from multiple sclerosis, and despite that, she raises awareness about it. She still works in films, she models, and she goes about it instead of giving up. And for me, that's a symbol of strength and resilience. So I told her that, and I told her that. It really inspired me because of my own challenges. So I went out of the window and I took this picture. Wow. This is Bibi Kai in Kalash, and she's one of the most famous places that has been photographed in the valley. And one day I went to Kalash 5 years ago for the first time, and I had printed out a photograph and I put it in my pocket. When I reached Kalash, I went to one of the valleys and I showed the picture, and the villager led me to her. And over the last 5 years, I kept on keeping track of her and following up. And last year, I took this picture. And although I don't speak Kalashi, she doesn't speak Urdu. We transcended that barrier, and today, she has actually adopted me as a grandson. I love exploring unknown areas. I love going to places which are not seen. It's a Dharkan corridor between KPK and Gilgit-Baltistan, and it's the most unique landscape I have seen. It has ice caves, to fields, to passes. As you know, some of you may know that when you go to any lake or path or mountain, in Pakistan, a lot of them tend to be named after the English. I tried to change that. I took a detour and I saw this uninhabited lake, and I decided to check it out, and I tried renaming it after myself. Unfortunately, it did not catch on, so I took a picture with it. I hope it catches on, maybe I could start a new trend. That place also features one of the highest lakes in the world. And this is me while climbing to a 16,000 feet high Dharkan pass. It is always very important to stay in touch with your subject as it is your friend, as yourself. So I photographed it 2 years back, last year, I gave you this picture, and I took even a better photograph, because didn't get gained the trust of your subject. I think most of the pictures you can see right now are behind the scenes at the moment, because a lot of my pictures are vertical. So you know, there was this place where I was camping, and this little girl, she knocked on my tent, and she told me to come up. And she pointed at the field behind her. And she told me that now we are going to play football. There were 11 locals playing against 4 of us. And needless to say, she kicked my butt. And that is her mother. Like I said, I love exploring unexplored places like Upper Chitral, where there are tons of lone trees. And I have also, you know, over there you meet different kinds of people. In Lahore, there is this at Mela Chiragan. You meet some serious people at a festival, some not so serious. This is a Parsi lady I was photographing in Karachi. And I was taking a picture from a distance. She did not know that, no, I was taking a picture until I spent way too much time taking a picture over there. And she went inside the house and she came up with a little piece of rod. And she started hitting the railing hard. And next thing I know, 30 cats came. I don't think you can see the full picture here, but what happened was that in the first picture you can see about 40 cats. Over time, it became less and less because it told a whole story. Always keep an eye out for something that is unusual. I remember I was exploring Ziyarat in Balochistan and I saw this canyon. I had no idea that this existed inside. And I explored Balochistan further. And this is a cave city, which used to be known as the Buddhist caves. Speaking of exploring, now I'm going to conclude my talk by telling you about something that's very close to my heart. When I was in final year in college, I asked myself, how can I be of use as an artist? I wanted to tell stories, something that I could really somehow share hope, share optimism, and I took pictures of everything, landscape and people. I went to NC Rawalpindi, which happened to be in Islamabad, and there's a restless ring over there. And I found a man who's 106 years old, and he was training restless, and he has a lot of great stories, and that inspired me to look at people. Now, when you see this is a cover of my book called Dharkan, The Heartbeat of a Nation. That's not the reason I've chosen this at the cover, which I'm going to tell you. When the Taliban entered into Sawad from Afghanistan, this is the first door they broke into. You know, they started terrorism, they exploited the culture of hospitality, and they broke here. But when the army flushed them out along with the locals, they painted the door with this very flag. And there's a lock on the door, which acts as a doorway to celebrating our unsung heroes, like the gutter cleaners, who earn 5,000 rupees every month. Well, get 3,000 rupees. And, you know, inside that gutter, you have toilet waste, you have a kitchen drainage, you have even body parts there. And he seemed to have some basic education and a sense of humor. So I asked him, why do you do this? Because his answer was that if we don't do this, then who will? And I wanted to explore more people. Like Abdul Chatayadi, more of our icons, Dalit Hussain, Tariq Aziz. Nobody knows that he's still hosting a show. Very few people are aware of that, and at 89 years of age. And that is the teacher of my teacher. Some of you may know him, Dr. Ajaz Albar. I remember once he was teaching a class, he was taking a history class, and there was a student who which are right in front of him, and he fell asleep, latently. So the doctor Ujjal woke him up and he said, "Ki wo mujhe dard nahi lagta." I'm going to conclude this talk by telling you about something that's very close to my heart and something that hit me really hard not that long ago. I was in Rawalpindi a couple of months back in December, and I just recalled that I was shooting at the exact same spot where Junaid Jamshed happened to be in Yesham. And because I had worked with him before, I was right there. And once I was done with the shoot, I WhatsApped Junaid because I had worked with him, and I told him that I want to try and unite members of Pakistan together. And he came online and he said, "Yes, we can definitely do this. I am in Chitral right now and I'm going to go to Islamabad from there, and then I'm going to Karachi next week." And next week we were supposed to meet. Unfortunately, 2 days later, the crash happened. And, you know, next week I was in Karachi and we were planning to meet on a Monday or a Tuesday. And on Tuesday, I was going back from Sindhi Muslim area back to my aunt's house in Defense. And I noticed there were lots of cars, lots of cameras. I looked to my left and I saw that there was a car carrying Junaid Jamshed's body. So we actually met, but not in the way we planned. You know, we tend to celebrate our icons, you know, after they pass away, and I like to cherish them. And well, like I said, every person there has a story, whether iconic or not iconic. Thank you very much.